Hi, I'm Mike Gerhauser. On behalf of the other elders and all who gather here, I want to say welcome to Resurgence Church. We are glad that you found us. Now, whether this is your first time joining us or you meet with us regularly, we pray that the message that you're about to hear would encourage you, would edify you in your faith, and would bring glory to God. We also want to encourage you to like and subscribe to our YouTube channel here. Don't forget to hit that bell so that you get notifications. And if you want to learn any more about us, you can go to our website at rsgchurch.com. There you can listen to past messages, you can give online, you can check our calendar of events, and you can see our statement of faith. Thank you again for joining us. Pray that you are blessed by the preaching of the word this morning. God bless you.
Today, this morning, church, we have the privilege, and it is a privilege, to talk about Jesus Christ and to consider Jesus Christ as the prophet, priest, and king. As we've been going through Advent, we're looking at different titles and names given to Jesus Christ. So we've looked at Jesus, the light of for the nations. We've looked at Jesus as the root of Jesse. And this morning, looking at Jesus as prophet, priest, and king. And normally we start with a scripture that we put up there. And we go kind of verse by verse through it. But what's interesting about this title this morning, like last week we saw the root of Jesse. I can take you right to the scripture. What's interesting about this is that you won't find it phrased this way exactly in the scriptures. It doesn't say Jesus is the prophet, priest, and king. Rather, that doesn't mean that it's not biblical. It just means that this is a doctrine that is drawn from the whole counsel of scripture rather than from a specific verse. It's a doctrine that's known as the munus triplex. Okay, so if you're taking notes, if you want to sound smart, you say it in Latin, okay? The munus triplex, it's simply munus like municipality or municipal. It means the threefold office, okay? That's it in the English. And even though we do see this throughout scripture, and it's even developed a little bit in the fourth century, it's really in the Reformation, you know, in the 1500s and 1600s, in the Reformation, that this doctrine really starts showing up in several confessions and catechisms. As the early reformers, they seek to regain and clearly express these biblical doctrines that form the foundation of our faith and our understanding of Jesus Christ, right? And understanding God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And I know myself, I've really grown over the years to appreciate these early confessions. If you've never gotten into any of the confessions of the catechisms, the Heidelberg or the Westminster Shorter, they're really beautiful. We've been going through them with my family for the way that they just express fundamental doctrines of our faith. And I've really come to understand and appreciate the importance of being trained up in those. And so I want to read a couple of them to you real quick. Excuse me. But one of the early catechisms that starts to develop this doctrine of the threefold office is the Heidelberg Catechism, which was written in 1563. Now, as a catechism, it's a teaching tool, and so it's phrased in questions and answers. And so the question there is, why is he called Christ, meaning anointed? We're going to talk more about that later, what anointed is. But this is the answer, and you'll hear this in there, right? Because he has been ordained by God the Father and has been anointed with the Holy Spirit to be our chief prophet and teacher, who perfectly reveals to us the secret counsel and will of God for our deliverance. That's the first one. Our only high priest, who has set us free by the one sacrifice of his body and who continually pleads our cause with the Father. There's our second. And our eternal King, who governs us by his word and spirit, and who guards us and keeps us in the freedom he has won for us. It's just, I love that so succinctly they put it there. About 80 years later, the Westminster Shorter Catechism comes out. Question 23, what offices doth Christ execute as our Redeemer? The answer for this, Christ as our Redeemer executes the offices of a prophet, of a priest, and of a king, both in his estate of humiliation and exaltation. Again, beautifully put. The next three questions in the Westminster go into, well, how does he execute the office of prophet? How does he execute priest? I won't read those, but there's a much more recent one called the New Hampshire Confession, this one from the United States, which was written and adopted in 1833 by the Baptist Convention in New Hampshire. And Article 8 of that one, it speaks of heartily, when it talks about our salvation, it talks about heartily receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as our prophet, priest, and king, and relying on him alone as the only and all-sufficient Savior. And I just love the way that one ends, because we will be talking about the all-sufficiency of Christ today and how that comes out in his fulfillment of this threefold office. Amen. So this is a well-established doctrine in the Orthodox teaching of the church. I know some people hear that word doctrine, they get a little weirded out by it, like it feels a little stuffy or a little restrictive to them or off-putting. But that word doctrine just means the teaching, right? And any doctrine that we hold to, well, it needs to be biblically based. It needs to be based on whatever Jesus said and the teaching of the apostles, right? And this doctrine of Jesus as prophet, priest, and king, it's really an important doctrine for the church to understand, because it speaks to not only what Christ did, but to who Christ is. And isn't that really the focus and the main thrust of the Christian life, right? That we wouldn't only be able to recite what Christ did, although that's important knowledge, but that we would grow in actually knowing who Christ is. Amen. And so I pray this morning that God will grant us that grace to grow in our knowledge of who Jesus is. Now, I said earlier that phrase doesn't show up specifically in Scripture, but the truth of it is all throughout Scripture. And one portion that comes very close to expressing it that way is found in Hebrews chapter 1, right in the beginning of Hebrews. And so we are going to, as we normally do, stand and read a Scripture together. So if you would stand with me. We're going to be taking a look at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. We'll use this as our jumping off point, and you will see it in here. So if you would read with me, this is what it says. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, today I have begotten you"? Or again, "I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son"? And again, when he brings the firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all God's angels worship him." Of the angels, he says, "He makes his angels winds and his ministers a flame of fire." But of the Son, he says, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions." You can take a seat. And let's pray before we get too far. Lord our God, we thank you for your word. I know we've come to you many times already today. And Lord, we will come to you many more times, recognizing and acknowledging our humble need for you, knowing that we are sustained by your word and by your power. So I thank you, pray that you would speak. Lord, give my voice strength even today to proclaim your goodness and your gospel in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we said, those verses that we just read, they don't say exactly prophet, priest, and king, but they come very close. And I'm going to kind of walk you through. If you have your Bibles, keep those open in front of you. You'll see it all right there. Matthew, if you want to kind of follow along with me on the screen, that's fine. But verse 1 begins by speaking of how God spoke through the prophets, right? Their role, the prophets' role, was to communicate the will and the wisdom of God to his people, okay? But in these last days, the scripture says, he has spoken to us by his Son. Now that establishes Jesus as fulfilling the role of a prophet. He is the instrument through whom God has communicated with his creation in these last days. But he's way more than just a prophet, because he not only reveals what God says, but he is himself the very word of God in a manifest physical form, the very presence of God. Verse 3 tells us that he is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. Now, we're going to talk more about that a little bit later. But clearly, the writer of Hebrews understands Jesus as prophet. Yes? If we go on to verse 3, it says, after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Now, the writer later develops how Jesus not only mediates the atonement, but is himself the sacrifice that accomplishes it. And, you know, in the old system, whose job was it to make purification for sins? It was the priest, right? That was the job. And so Jesus here is described as fulfilling the office of the priest. It's said that he makes purification for sins. Now, again, later when we get into Hebrews, it's just a beautiful book. If you read through it, the writer actually spends the better part of 5 chapters developing this fact that Jesus is not just a priest, but he is the greater priest in the order of Melchizedek, right? Who is without beginning and without end. In fact, that name, Melchizedek, speaks to our last office that we're going to be talking about, the office of king. Because in the Hebrew, the name Melchizedek literally translates to king of righteousness. But we also know from Genesis 14 that Melchizedek is referred to as the king of Salem. Well, that word Salem, where we get shalom, it means peace. So we have in Melchizedek, we have a picture of Christ, who is both king of righteousness as well as king of peace. Amen. But this office of king is found in the verses that we started with as well. If we look back to Hebrews 1, at the end of verse 3, we read that it says that he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. So that puts him in pretty close proximity to the majesty, right? The sovereign over the universe. But later in verses 8 and 9, the writer quotes from Psalm 45, and he's going to apply these verses to Jesus Christ. He says, but of the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of uprightness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness beyond your companions. So there we see this psalm applied to Jesus Christ, right? And first of all, it calls him God. Well, the sovereignty and kingship of God, I don't think many people would call into question, okay? So we say, well, God is sovereign, God is king, yes. Well, this is now applied to Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is king. But even more than that, we get this series of words that make it very clear that Jesus is a king. We see words like throne, scepter, kingdom, and anointed. Right? Well, think of what those first three belong to a king, right? The king has the throne. He has the scepter, a picture of his righteousness and his power, and he has the kingdom. What is a king without a kingdom, right? And that last word, anointed, is frequently used throughout the Old Testament to speak of the king. If you remember David, think of all the times that David could have killed Saul. Remember that? He says, but I would not lift my hand against the Lord's anointed. And so this section in Hebrews is just one of the places where we see these three offices attributed to Jesus throughout Scripture. And so this is a thoroughly biblical doctrine, but it still took some time in the church to kind of formulate the significance of the doctrine and put it into a cohesive language and work out the significance of it. And when we look back in church history, the first place it really takes place as a unified doctrine, besides being established in Scripture, is through a man named Eusebius. Now, Eusebius of Caesarea, he was a bishop and a historian living in the 4th century. He's known as the father of church history. Oh, thank you. I'm running out of water. It doesn't really do anything, but, you know, I'll appreciate it. Sarah put all this tape for the kids to know where they're standing for the Christmas play, which just keeps sticking to my feet. All right. Excuse me. So we look back in church history, we see Eusebius. He was a historian. He is known as the father of church history because he writes a book. He was the first one to kind of put together in some cohesive order the early church history, and he calls it church history. That's what it's called, the history of the church. And what's interesting about this is what Eusebius does is he looks back at the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament that he had access to. He looks back at the Septuagint and he finds all these people that are referred to as Christ. Right now you'd be like, whoa, what, there's more than one Christ. Well, that word Christ means anointed. It is the Greek counterpart to Messiah or Mashiach in the Hebrew, right? And so they just simply mean, we talked last week about Cyrus being called God's Messiah because he was anointed. And so Eusebius looks back and he sees where men were called Christ or when they were anointed. And he finds these three offices in the Old Testament where men were anointed or where they were set apart by having oil poured on their heads. And these three offices were the priest, the king, and the prophet. Now, first we see the priests referred to as anointed throughout it. We see throughout scripture that the priests are anointed throughout Leviticus and Deuteronomy. But one quick example I'll give you, Leviticus 4:5. It says, "And the priest that is anointed shall take of the bullock's blood and bring it to the tabernacle of the congregation." So all throughout scripture, they're anointed. The priests are anointed. Next, we move to 1 Samuel. We see the king referred to as the anointed, right? Samuel first anoints Saul as king, and then he anoints David as king, pouring oil over his head. And I already mentioned before how David refers to Saul as the Lord's anointed. And so we see kings anointed. And finally, although we don't see this too much in scripture, in 1 Kings 19:16, the Lord is speaking to Elijah here. Okay, if you remember, this is the scene when Elijah's hiding out in the cave, comes right after that whole scene on Mount Carmel, where he destroys like 400 prophets of Baal, right? The priests of Baal. And then he runs away and he hides in a cave. And then we have the whirlwind and the fire and all this stuff. And then God speaks to him in a still small voice. Okay, this is that scene. And this is what God says to him. In verse 15 and 16, it says, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu, the son of Nimshi, you shall anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha, the son of Shaphat, and of Abel-Meholah, you shall anoint to be prophet in your place." And so we see these three offices being anointed. In the Hebrew, they would then be messiahs, right? Or Mashiachs. In the Greek, it is Christ. Now, listen, that's not to say that they are Jesus at all, okay? But what Eusebius points out is that these are shadows. These are types that point to the one who would come, who is the Christ of God, who is the anointed one. Eusebius writes this, he says, "So that all these have reference to the true Christ, the divinely inspired and heavenly word, who is the only high priest of all, the only king of every creature, and the Father's only supreme prophet of prophets." So this is where the doctrine of munus triplex, or the threefold office, really starts to take shape. And we're going to get into why it matters. We're going to get into how Jesus does all three, what it means for us as believers. But I want to just take a quick minute before we get into that, just to look at more specifically about those offices and how Jesus fulfills them. Okay? Bear with me. Hopefully your ears aren't bleeding by the end of this. I apologize. It's not painful for me, so don't worry about me. First, looking at the office of the prophet. Amos 3:7 says that the Lord God does nothing without revealing his secret to his servants, the prophets. All right. So the prophets, when we think about the prophets, they are, in a sense, they are channels of revelation, right? These are men who know the mind of God. They know the heart of God and they reveal it to his people. They are enabled to declare it. Now, a lot of times when we think of prophets and we think of prophecy, we think about like telling the future, right? We think about this far-reaching future kind of stuff, but it's really important to know that although that's something they definitely do in the Old Testament, they're not just fortune tellers. Prophets are not fortune tellers. Even in the context of foretelling the future, really the primary concern of the prophets is to communicate the word of God in the here and now. That's their role. They're most often bringing correction from God, all right? And that's not just some future correction. That's a here and now correction. They speak his word and they speak his will in order that the people would come into conformity with his will. Does that make sense? All right. That's what they're proclaiming. A lot of the future stuff is, well, this is what's going to happen if you don't and when you don't. Right. And so in Deuteronomy 18, Moses calls himself a prophet and he tells the people that he promises that God will give them another prophet like him raised up from their own people. So from the Jewish people will come a prophet like Moses. Well, we know that that is fulfilled in Jesus Christ, that he is the prophet like Moses, right? But I found this really interesting, why he says that God sent prophets. And it was really in response to the people's requests. So just kind of fleshing out prophets. If we look at Deuteronomy 18, starting in verse 15, Moses says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen, just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly, when you said, 'Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, or see this great fire anymore, lest I die.' And the Lord said to me, 'They are right in what they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him.'" Now, what Moses is referring back to, this, I love this as I was just studying this week. He's referring back to Exodus chapter 20. All right. And if we look there, this is shortly after Israel comes out of Egypt. Okay. They're in the wilderness. And this is the first time that God gives the Ten Commandments. And I don't know how I didn't realize this, but the first time God gives the Ten Commandments, he's speaking it to the people directly. He speaks the Ten Commandments to the people. You know, we often think of Moses coming down the mountain with the Ten Commandments, with the two tablets, right? And then and then he sees the golden calf and all that stuff, and he gets mad and he smashes the Ten Commandments, and he has to go get a second pair, right? I always think of that as the scene of the Ten Commandments, and that does happen, but that's not till Exodus chapter 32. Back here in Exodus chapter 20 is the first time that God proclaims the Ten Commandments, and he proclaims it to the people directly. They're terrified. The result is that they're absolutely terrified. Exodus 20, 18, God has just finished speaking the words of the Ten Commandments, and it says this: "Now, when all the people saw the thunder and the flashes of lightning and the sound of the trumpet and the mountain smoking, the people were afraid and trembled, and they stood far off. And they said to Moses, 'You speak to us, and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us, lest we die.'" Now, of course, we know that they don't listen to Moses when he does speak to them. But that's what Moses is talking about here in Deuteronomy when he says that God is sending another prophet. And really, I think why God spoke through prophets in general, because the people said, "We don't want to hear from God directly. Speak to us through a prophet." Now, it's funny, people always say they want to hear God directly. But here we have an instance where they do, and they're terrified. Right? And they say, "Please, let's have no more of that. Okay? Let's have a mediator. Let's get the words of God through a mediator." But of course, when they get his words through a mediator, and I'm not just pointing fingers, when we get his words through a mediator, how often do we not listen? Right? I think of Jeremiah. If you remember in Jeremiah, great example, Judah has just fallen to Babylon. People are taken out of Judah, and there's a remnant left in Judah. Okay? And they're deciding, what do we do? Do we stay in the decimated land or do we go to Egypt? They say, "Jeremiah, you go to God, find out what we're supposed to do, and we'll do whatever you tell us." And Jeremiah says, "Fine, good plan." He goes to God. God says, "Whatever you do, don't go to Egypt. Stay in the land." Jeremiah comes back. He says, "This is what God says. Just don't go to Egypt." They say, "You're lying. We're going to Egypt," right? So right away, they head to Egypt. So we know. Well, whatever. We know there's sin in our hearts, right? But a prophet has the very words of God, you know, and that's no small thing. In fact, they often started, "Thus saith the Lord," or hear the word of the Lord, right? That what they're saying is directly from God, and you better not get something like that wrong, right? It's a bold thing to say, thus saith the Lord. So that's what the prophets did. Now, how do we see Jesus in this office? Well, we already saw in Hebrews how the writer makes this comparison, right, between Jesus and the prophets, saying that in these last days, rather than speaking through the prophets, he speaks to us through his son, and we have it through Jesus Christ. But more than that, the Gospel of John tells us that Jesus Christ is the Word of God, not just proclaiming the Word of God, not just carrying the Word of God, but is the Word of God. Now, remember that we said that this is all about the supremacy of Christ. This message is all about the supremacy of Christ. And in this, we see Jesus as not only relating the words of God, but actually embodying and manifesting the word of God in himself, in what he says, in what he does, in what he accomplishes. In John 12:49, Jesus says, "For I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me has himself given me a commandment what to say and what to speak." So we see there, well, who does that? Who speaks the word of God? The prophets, right? And so we see Jesus is a prophet. The woman at the well in John chapter 4, if you remember, she says, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." Well, she got that right, right? But he was so much more than that. Regarding the word of God, many of us, when we think of the word of God, we might think of Isaiah 55:11, right? We know this one. It says, "So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose and shall succeed in the thing for which I sent it." And we think of that scripture when we think about things like this, like the proclamation of God's word. We say, oh, well, it won't return to him void. It won't return to him empty. That the word proclaimed will accomplish what God intends for it to accomplish. Amen. It's not in the eloquence of the speaker. It's in the power of his word and his will to accomplish what he will accomplish. And so this is true for every prophecy ever uttered by the prophets. But listen, it is doubly true of Jesus Christ. Because he not only spoke the words that accomplished God's purpose, but he himself was the word sent from God that returned to God, having accomplished all that was purposed and having succeeded in the thing for which it was sent. Amen. He says, the word's not going to come back to me without doing what it needs to do. And then we get Jesus Christ, the word of God, who returns to him after saying it is finished, having accomplished all that he would accomplish. And so Jesus doesn't just fill the role of prophet. He fulfills the role of a prophet as the supreme witness of God's will and of God's mind and of God's heart. Amen. He speaks to the people, we see in scripture, as one with authority, it so often says in the Gospels. And the people are amazed that he speaks as one with authority because he is the very word of God. And he not only speaks the will of God, but is himself the revelation of God's will. And listen, the accomplishing agent of that will. All right, he not only speaks, he's not only revealing the will, but he is the accomplishing agent of that will. And how he accomplishes that. That takes us to our next office, to the office of the priest. And although the Bible mentions priests as far back as Genesis, it's not until Exodus that they really start getting developed a bit more. Like we hear about the priest of Midian and the priest of On and all these different priests. You know, Joseph's father-in-law was a priest of On, which was an important city in Egypt. But in Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Numbers, we start getting a development of what the priests do. And we see that the primary role of the priest is to act as an intermediary between God and man, right? It's the job of the priest first to minister to God. In the case of the Levitical priesthood, this included making sure that the rituals of the temple worship were followed, like the lamp was burning, the showbread was baked and presented every week or every day, that the daily sacrifices were made. This was the job of the priests. And then there were the sacrifices of the people. For the people that they needed to bring for their own needs, for their sins, for their transgressions, for thanksgiving and for guilt offerings, right? And the priests, they regulated and executed those sacrifices as well. They took the animal, they slaughtered it, They burned up the parts that were supposed to be burned up. They poured out what they were supposed to sprinkle. They waved the parts that were supposed to be waved. Okay, they executed that part of it. And so the major roles of the priests were to make atonement for sin, to manage the sacrifices, and to point man to God. And there's a lot to say on this subject just from the book of Hebrews alone. So I encourage you to read it. I'm not going to go through all of it. He spends, like I said, the better part of 5 chapters really developing Christ as the great high priest. I'm going to try for the sake of time to just give a brief summary. But Hebrews 5:1 says that every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. So gives us a good picture of what the priest does. But as the writer points out, Jesus is superior. Listen, he is superior in his fulfillment of this office too. Because every high priest has to not only make atonement for the sins of those that he represents, but he comes to God with himself with sin to be atoned for, right? The supremacy of Christ comes from the fact that, as Hebrews 4:15 says, he was in every aspect, in every respect, tempted as we are, yet was without sin. So not only this, but Hebrews 7:23 tells us that the former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But he, that is Jesus, holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. So now the next verse tells us the significance of that. We're like, well, why does that matter that he holds this priesthood forever? It says, consequently, listen, this is why Christians rejoice. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Amen. And I feel like one of those infomercials, because I want to be like, but wait, there's more. All right. So not only is Jesus superior in this office in that he has no sin of his own to atone for, not only is he superior in that he lives forever and so holds the office permanently, but his sacrifice is superior because rather than shed the blood of goats and bulls, which scripture tells us can never take away sins, he shed his own blood, which purifies completely and eternally by the merit of his perfect righteousness. Hebrews 10:11 says, and every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering, listen, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. Church, that's you and me. Hebrews 9:12 says he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. Perfected for all time, securing an eternal redemption. Finally, the third office that Christ fulfills as the Christ, as the anointed, is the office of king. And again, we know that earthly kings are but a shadow of the true king, right? When Israel asks for a king, they did a bad thing, right? What they did is they rejected God as their king in favor of a broken, imperfect human king. And God tells them what they'll get, right? Just the same, God gives it to them. And in the king, we see an imperfect representation of the perfect lordship and sovereign rule of Jesus. But what does a king do? Well, we see in scripture that they rule their people. And that means that they are responsible for the safety of their people. That means that they're responsible to lead the army into battle against their enemies. We see what happens when the minute David doesn't lead the army into battle, right? That's when the whole thing Bathsheba starts. Mm-hmm. So a king ought to lead his people to battle, fight for them. They're responsible for administering justice and making sure that the weakest among their people are not exploited by those with power. They're tasked with establishing peace and prosperity for their people, to govern in a way that allows for their people to flourish. And we see Jesus fulfill all of this as well. In John 18, when he's being questioned by Pilate, Jesus as much as admits that he is a king, right? So we have the authority and the testimony of Jesus Christ as to his kingship. He says, my kingdom is not of this world. Well, who has a kingdom? A king, right? If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews, but my kingdom is not from the world. But more than this, we see Jesus doing the things that a king does. We've already read in Hebrews 1 how God speaks of his throne, and he speaks of his scepter, and he speaks of being anointed. But we see Jesus fulfill the role of king as the one who protects us, the one who provides for us. Philippians 4:19 says, my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Romans 8:37, we talk about victory. Romans 8:37 tells us that in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us, right? We're not just going out there and you know, winning everything. It's through him. But I also don't want to give the wrong impression here, because we often talk about like God fighting our battles and Jesus fighting for us. I don't want to give the impression to say that because Jesus fights our battles that we've got it easy. And life's going to be without challenges, and we're not going to face any battles. We're not going to face any struggles, because that's not true. Scripture promises that we're going to have trouble, right? 2 Timothy 3:12 says, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. But we can rejoice knowing that, listen, the greatest battle has already been fought, already been won by Jesus Christ, and our eternities are secured through his victory. You know, a lot of people, when they talk about David and Goliath, they're like, we need to be like David and fight the giants. No, Christ is the David. And we're the Israelites shaking in our boots. And after Jesus has the victory, what do the Israelites do? Then they chase after them all, right? Like, yeah. Now, like, he already killed the giant. You know, and they're like, yeah, and if you come back, you know, that's our role, right? To follow in the victory of Christ. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15 says, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. If we go back to Hebrews chapter 2, starting in verse 14, we read, since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. You get this picture of people being enslaved, and Jesus defeats the enemy and frees the slaves. That's you and me. We are enslaved in our fear of death. That's all the way back. I teach literature. I teach my students, like, you go back to the Epic of Gilgamesh. You go back to the Enuma Elish. You go back to the earliest stories, to the Iliad and the Odyssey. What are they all about? They're about the heroes who are trying to gain immortality through their fame. Early man realized, we die. That's our big problem. How are we going to stop that? You know, when the early heroes, the Greek heroes and stuff, they thought through fame, you know, through mighty deeds, they would have their story told and they would gain immortality. But we know the secret. We know the way to true life. So Christ had the victory. He defeated the enemy of our souls. But he also provides everything that we need. Now listen, not everything you want, but everything we need, okay? 2 Peter 2:3 says, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. We spoke last week about Jesus fulfilling the prophecies of Isaiah 11, that picture of him as the root of Jesse. And we said that Jesus was the righteous king in the line of David that was able to do everything that those earthly kings could not do. And we see a perfect description again of this. I found this in Jeremiah 23. I wish I had this scripture last week, but I missed it. But listen to what it says in Jeremiah 23. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch. Same thing as we see in Isaiah 11. He shall reign as king and deal wisely and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. That's what Christ does. As king, Jesus deals wisely. He executes justice and righteousness in the land. He offers peace, but he will also punish the wicked and those who reject the salvation offered through him. Now, there's much more that could be said about how Jesus fulfills his threefold office. Bear with me. We're wrapping it up here. I want to speak just for a moment on the significance of the fact that he does fulfill all three of those. I have an excerpt from John Flavel. He was a Puritan preacher who has a book called Christ and His Threefold Office. And he says, I'll give you just succinctly, he says that through prophet, he reveals the salvation. Through priest, he purchases the salvation. And through king, he applies the salvation. Now, that's beautiful that each are accomplished, but we see the synthesis of these things happening, that it's significant that Jesus does all three. He says, in vain it is revealed if not purchased. And in vain it is revealed and purchased if not applied. Amen. And what I love about that is it testifies to the necessity of Christ holding all three of those, holding the threefold office. It points to the all-sufficiency of Christ in the fact that there is this synthesis to where each office kind of amplifies the other. So that Christ is preeminent in all things. Amen. Now, like I said, we could go much deeper into the ways that Jesus fulfills these offices and the benefit that we have in that. But I just want to finish our time by bringing up one important point for our consideration. You know, that we could walk out of here at this point and praise God. We should hear a message like this and say, thank you, Jesus. You know, what does that do for us? That draws us to knowing Christ. Say, thank you, Jesus, that you do all these things. And we recognize that he is our sovereign and we are submitted and yielded to him. That's a good thing. But I want to point out that in as much as we are in Christ as believers through faith, God has also made us prophets, priests, and kings. And that's a little bit of like a mind blow, you know, right there. I don't have a whole lot of time to spend on this. I know it sounds shocking at first. I want to be careful how I qualify this because we are not Christ, okay? We are not Christ, but we are Christians, amen? We are followers of Christ, and God has intended from the beginning for his people to be a royal priesthood. In fact, we see that phrase show up in both 1 Peter and in Revelation. Back in Exodus 19, when God is establishing his covenant with the people, Moses sprinkles blood on all of them, just as he does to the priests to anoint them. And it says this, you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. And so I'm going to leave you just with this morning, that one of the great privileges and great responsibilities that we have as Christians is that we participate by grace through faith in Christ's anointing. And through union with Christ, we participate in that threefold office. As prophets, we confess the word of God, don't we? Now, that's not just what I'm doing up here. I'm not just saying, that's not just this. That's not just telling the future. That is what each of us should be doing every day, confessing the word of God as we live our lives openly, confessing the wonderful power and mercy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But we also serve as priests. Luther and Calvin developed this doctrine that they call the priesthood of all believers, or the universal priesthood. And of course, we don't fulfill that office the same way that Jesus does. But as priests, we minister to God and we point men to God, right? Priests, one of their jobs is to help make God known to the people. And that's what all of us as believers are called to do. Whether it's in church ministry or it's by walking your dog and talking to the neighbor. And then they bring up some hardship that they're going through and you offer to pray for them. Or you show the supremacy of Christ in their situation, right? We are ministering. Now listen, we don't make atonement through our blood, but scripture does call us to offer ourselves as living sacrifices, right? And it does call us to intercede in 1 Timothy 2:1. That's what the priest does. And so in those ways, we fulfill the role of a priest. And finally, we serve as kings, a royal priesthood, scripture says. And we reign to the extent that we are in Christ, currently seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, right? Well, that's according to Ephesians 2:6. Where is Christ currently seated? On his throne, right? We're seated with him. I think that's more than just a pretty figure of speech. But we're also called to administer justice on this earth, to stand for truth, to stand for righteousness, as the king would minister justice, declaring the truth of what God has called good, and calling evil what God has called evil. Now that happens in the here and now, but there's also a future fulfillment of this. expressed in places like Daniel 7:27, Revelation 5:9 and 10, Revelation 20, 2 Timothy 2:12, which says this, if we endure, we will also reign with him. So church, we will reign with Christ. Paul tells us we will judge angels. Romans 8:27 says that we are co-heirs with Christ. Christ inherits the kingdom. And we will one day be given crowns. Of course, we will throw those at the feet of Jesus. But listen, I don't say all of that to make much of us. That's important, okay? I say that to make much of him and to recognize and to rejoice in the amazing, undeserved gift. I just want to say she's doing fantastic. She's done great, all right, the whole time. Done great. But we say this to make much of Christ, amen? To recognize that the amazing, undeserved gift that he has given to us through his son, Jesus, and the outpouring of grace upon grace. So as we continue, church, in this Advent season, let us continue fixing our eyes on Jesus, considering this week and meditating on the awesome fulfillment of these offices that God has accomplished in Jesus Christ and what that means for us as we await his return. Amen? Amen. Thank you for bearing with me. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your mercy. I thank you that, scratchy as it was, you just held my voice together. And Lord, we just rejoice in what you have done, and we rejoice in the beauty of Jesus Christ, in the fullness of who he is, and all that you have done through him and in him, all that you've done in us, and how you have brought us to yourself, Lord. I thank you for your people. I thank you for the ears willing to hear, and pray that you would work a fruitful harvest in the hearts of those that are yours. We praise you in Jesus' perfect name. Amen. Amen.